Okay, let's get started. Hi, good afternoon, and greetings to everyone that attended to our session here. In today's session, me, Fanshi Zhang, with another amazing developer, Kebe Liu here, will be presenting to our work on some of the work we have done so far on distributed training of AI and related workloads. But don't worry if you are not familiar with machine learning or distributed training. We will get you covered when introducing the concepts. Before we get started, let's introduce ourselves. We are the software engineers come from DaoCloud, one of the famously known corporations that put much efforts into open source and Kubernetes ecosystem. With now primarily focusing on the field to cohere Kubernetes and AI together. As background, Kebe Liu is one of the members of Istio steering committee. While working on AI stuff, he is also focusing on other cloud native projects like Istio eBPF in recent years. Me, Fanshi Zhang, I'm a software engineer too at DaoCloud, focusing on AI and Kubernetes, also a contributor to Kubernetes community, as well as for Golang and Vue. Okay, without further ado, let's jump right into the rabbit hole and see what we have prepared for you today. The first one thing to get off is distributed training. To recap to everyone what distributed training is, let's start with basics. In machine learning field, model is basically a set of matrix and vectors, which is used to predict the output based on the input data. Say we have the set of vectors. But that's not the whole picture. Let's zoom out for a little bit. Well, this is the visualization of every fundamental building block of every machine learning models, or Hinton diagram, if you like. With that, the concept of training is just splitting data into different slices and blocks, which we call batches. What do we do next? We will send and feed them into CPU and GPU hardware devices to perform computation and as well as inference. Surely we now understand that what model is and what was doing during training. There comes challenges. In modern days, models are getting larger and larger. They wouldn't be able to fit in any single instance of GPU. Therefore, to deal with the too large problem, we will need to distribute them into multiple GPU clusters. Okay, everything seems fine. More GPU means faster training, right? Or is it? It turns out the memory and power consumption will not only be the only problem that we'll face, but also the failures. Sure, why do failures occur? Before we dive into deeper, let's take a step back into the common issues. First one, hardware failures, network issues, and software bugs. Let's take a look at this log we've captured by executing the message when inspecting the syslog. The line indicates GPU has fallen off the bus, and the NVIDIA probe routine failed for one device. Those are the common issues that we will face when dealing with GPU and PCIe's from the perspective view of kernel. This is another one related to Nico. This was captured during some training experiments with PyTorch. We can see that the connection was closed by local rank zero, and the Nico watchdog thread terminated with exception. Okay. And the last one, this is the software bug that was captured during the training process. Okay, let me highlight it. Okay, we can see that the error was caused by mistype issue when we are expecting float, but instead we get BF, B float 16. So where is the so-called irreversible issues? And sorry to spend so many slides to build up the context and the fundamental. You have done so well. Okay, and please allow me to explain more on how distributing training works in PyTorch with additional slide. Instead of a normal deployment, distributed training jobs more like a stateful set. When bootstrapping, the main node will be the first one to start, then negotiating with the other nodes to join the training Sunico. While both calculate the topology, connectivity, and bandwidth, etc. Once everyone is ready, mini-batch will be calculated and sent to each node. During training, every step or epoch, a ring or reduce or reduce operation will be performed across nodes. Okay, that's too many words, I know. Don't worry, relax. Let's simulate one interactively. Let's look at the overview first. Say we have a distributed training job that running on a GPU cluster. Pay attention to those how error is propagated from one node to another in the following animation. Sure, for given nodes in a cluster that running distributed training, the main node will be the first one, and the rest of our worker node. Once everything is ready, the training will be started. However, what if one node or part encounters some critical issues due to NICO or GPU failures? And that's the most interesting part. See the propagation of error from one node to the other? That's kind of way to abstract it. I know, here's the explanation. By that means, when one of the node failed for NICO-based distributed training, every node requires another node for keep live signals for their connectivity to respond continuously. When it comes to one node to fail, then at this scenario, NICO failed, or NICO network is hanging, well, nothing gets done, right? Everyone is basically sit there and keep waiting. How can we resolve this issue? Sure, we can kill them all entirely, then they will get restarted. There must be something wrong. First, the distributed algorithm is purely implemented by PyTorch or NICO itself. It's hard to debug, trace, and make it managed or controlled. Second, unlike nowadays Kubernetes operators, healing, orchestrating, still hard to achieve. It's hard to accomplish auto heal, auto recover, auto mitigate. Obviously, we have no ways to detect what's happening. Third is detecting the failure of drivers, hardwares, GPUs, or even network is still a challenge. We don't even know the root cause or how to collect the needed events and the logs, and there's lack support of observability. Things didn't stop there. There's still more. Remember how the nodes will be mitigated? When we're recovering the training job, we can't just simply migrate those parts to another node. We still need to transfer the needed checkpoint files. However, checkpoints are large. For example, Llama 2 has roughly 83 gigabytes of checkpointing files. Due to the limited bandwidth of NFS, shared volumes, RDMA, saving 80 gigabytes of files and above level checkpoint files requires high speed of I/O to reduce the downtime. Mitigation requires transferring these checkpoints across different nodes, even cross clusters. If one of the GPU nodes fell down, hundreds of gigabytes of files will be transferred immediately to another node. With that word, we would say I/O and the storage will be another challenge we'll need to face. Hold on, just check. Okay. Let's sum it up with more stereotypical and mathematical way. We break it down into these factors to calculate how much time it would take to train a model. With them, the formula forms, there's factors about number of nodes, number of paths, how long can we detect to finish the diagnosis, perform the mitigation. I know it's hard to understand, but let's simplify it. In a nutshell, there are three major factors that we can improve. The first one is reduce the diagnostic time. The second one is reduce the reconcile or mitigation migration time. The third one is to speed up the checkpoints. Eventually, we can reduce the total training time cost. Okay. We said that we've understood those issues and challenges I stated. Let's take a look at some of the state-of-the-art blogs, tryout, and researchers. The first one would be big science. They encountered some hardware issues where the frequency will be 1 and 2 for a week. And each time one GPU failed will cause them to lose 1.5 hours, which is 1.5 hours, by just recovering it. They described the same issue I showed you before in the simulation animation. Sometimes the training gets stuck despite a crashing process and nodes doesn't quit. Fortunately, they finally managed to get it automated. Yay. Okay, what about the meta? They trained Llama 3 45B model on a massive 24,000 GPU cluster. Surely, they developed a new advanced new training stack that automates error detection, handling, and maintenance to maximize the GPU uptime. They managed to detect the silent data corruption and develop a new system to speed up the checkpoint and rollback. The improvement is huge. They managed to reduce the training time by more than 95% and increase the efficiency by 3 times by comparing to Llama 2. Okay, we learned that big science and meta have tried. Who else have tried to solve this issue? Clearly, everyone understands the challenges now. There are two projects we found that solve the problem from two different perspectives. One of it is JobSet, a Kubernetes project. It's easy to extend, however, it cannot handle events from pods and doing log analysis and performing periodic inspection. The second one is DR Rover, a trainer-oriented project. It's PyTorch native, ready to use out of box. However, it cannot perform periodic inspection and not extensible to various different frameworks, like it's built for Python, just as a extended Python PyTorch trainer. That's it. There are still some of the archive papers that you can read and understand more about. I put them here for you to reference. Since we have spent our time on layering concepts and knowledges, let's see what we have done so far. Here's Kirby to tell you more.
Hello, I'm Kirby. Let me to introduce our new project. It's named KeyCover. This is our single install Google plugin solution combined with a node problem detector and operator. Let's dive into the core features of KeyCover. Firstly, there is a firewatch of workloads. This feature will continuously monitor the status of training jobs workloads, such as PyTorch job, and promptly detect any error messages. Next, enhanced observability will be implemented by optimizing various means to determine the status of jobs. such as observing logs and real-time system calls, thus enhance the observability of training jobs. Through periodical inspection, we will regularly test the status of jobs, the environment, infrastructure to ensure that the resource committed to training jobs meet the required condition, ensure smooth training process. With cascading shutdown, when a fault occurs that prevents the training jobs from continuing, to entire job will be restarted through cascading shutdown. This prevents the training framework from waiting due to a long waiting path, thus avoiding the waste of valuable hardware resources. Finally, intelli-migration will intelligently assist the health status of nodes to determine where they can continue running jobs, ensuring the maximized resources optimization while safeguarding training efficiency. Okay, let's talk about the architecture of KCover. The architecture of KCover contains of two parts, collector and controller, also known as recovery manager. The controller runs as a demonstrator on each load, responsible for gathering information. This includes executing the DCGMI commands, analyzing logs and events of each pod, and invoking some system calls, such as checking the status of PCIe devices and determine the optional of status jobs. It reports any exceptional events back to the API server. The controller keeps an eye on events relayed by the API server and further analyze the data gained by the collector. Based on the analysis, it decides if a job needs to be restarted. If a restart is necessary, the controller will reboot the entire job, and may also mark the load as unscheduled to prevent further assignment. I just introduced the features and architecture. So why can it? Once a training job is enabled, KCover will continuously analyze the information. This includes node status, container logs such as Nico, CUDA, or OM errors, as well as specific exist codes. If a problem is detected, we will record the event through the collector and may initiate a cascading shutdown to restart the job, allowing it to resume the training from the last load status. Additionally, through ongoing diagnostic tool will analyze the network status, GPU hardware status, PCIe status, and the kernel status to ensure that the system always operates at optimal conditions. So, how to use it? How to use KCover? To start using KCover, you can initially install KCover on your system with a few simple helm commands. You only need to execute the helm install command to install KCover on your cluster. Subsequently, when submit training jobs, such as a PyTorch job, you only need to set a label to a job, like this. This allows KCover to continuously monitor your job, ensuring that that it can be quickly recovered after a failure without need to manual intervention. Okay, let's back to Fanshi to introduce the features of roadmap of KCover.
Sure, thanks Kirby for introducing everything. Okay, I know. There's still much work need to be done. For example, we could plan for more event analysis, which DCGMI, NVIDIA SMI, Nicole Test, etc. Even extending the support of JAX, okay, the new de facto machine learning framework by Google, or more types of analysis, or more integrated solutions. The above discusses some of the current feature of the technical details of KCover. Glad this project is not already open source, and you can find it at here with the QR code on the screen. We warmly welcome everyone to help us. Suggestions or feedbacks are greatly appreciated. Sure, we couldn't make it without any communities. We wanted to shout out to the community for the following improvements to discuss with. This is the list. First one, we want to shout out to propose a universal trainer health check implementation for PyTorch, as well as other frameworks, trainers, for observability. Maybe we could together build a better analysis and root cause debugging on top of Kubernetes, and even ask for frameworks to try to expose more observability metrics for training, logging, and monitoring instead of just using tensor boards. For example, we could integrate promises or open telemetry. Finally, how about implement a universal stateless negotiator layer on top of those TensorFlow, PyTorch, and JAX, so we can extend it like how Kubernetes scheduler plugin does. With all of that, that's the end of today's session. I bet many of you may ask how to make this PPT. We open sourced it, but it built with codes, so it will require you to have the front-end knowledges to read it. We would like to ask you for giving us a sum up on the sketch for feedbacks, and do we have anyone have any questions? Oh, and both of us can speak Chinese. It's okay to use Chinese.
But your talk is in English, so let me try, yeah, if I can.
Sorry.
Yeah, firstly, congratulations, this great talk and excellent talk, a lot of insight. And yeah, I'm from NVIDIA, and I think that's a very important problem. So looks to me, and your approach is more like a reactive and a solution. So can you comment what about some more like a proactive approach based on prediction, for example? Do you think that's realistic or practical? And can predict, for example, the future based on some data, then you can take some actions and proactively instead of reactive.
Can I understand it like?
Okay, 我的问题就是说，你现在这个方法更多的像是个 reactive, 对吧? Something bad happened, then you take actions.
Yes, yes.
是不是可以有一些 proactive 或者更预测性的方法？你觉得这是不是可行的？你们有没有朝这个方向，对吧？基于历史说，我觉得这个 node 有可能更大的可能性 fail， 我可能先采取一些措施来避免。
Yes.
或者你们的 state of art study 是不是也有一些发现？对。
Yes. Okay. So back to this slide, when we have different of modules to perform this. Middle one is the periodic inspection. We will perform Nicole test and DCGMI periodically across all the management node to test whether a node is having PCI issues or having some increasing rate of GPU errors. That's possible, and we have tried. Yes.
Okay, the second question is you mentioned other people's work that leverage the checking pointing. So is there any, if I understand correctly, your approach has not used the checking pointing yet? So what's the plan, or you don't think it's a practical approach, or what's the plan for it?
Okay, good question. With that, it's hard to say whether a Kubernetes perspective of operator or controller should take this responsibility of handling checkpoint transfer. So first thing for the DL rover, okay, let me mark it. Let me use cursor to point. Okay, for DL rover, they implement something called fast checkpoint recovery, which was implemented through using a memory-based cache to load checkpoints and flush them out when it's possible. So I would think for responsibility, Kubernetes operator or controller should not handle the fast checkpoint recover, but we can handle the PVC migration. That's for sure to have. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned, you are looking for collaboration with NVIDIA. I'm looking forward to it too. Thank you.
Okay, sure, thank you very much. Glad to hear that. Any other questions?在我们现在已经我提交过的 PI 的实现当中呢，有一部分是通过我们直接硬编码的，比方说 CUDA 的错误、CLDN 错误和 NICO 的错误，硬编码了那个开头字符串，以及记录了它的退出码来去检测它的错误的。Okay, for English version, I submitted one of the pull requests to implement the container log analysis, which will require us to hard encode those keywords of error from CUDA, CLDN, NICO, and everything else one by one by hand by experience. And that's, 在我看来，我觉得我们目前的这个现有的这些工具，或者说 infra 开发的工具上是没有足够能够复现这部分错误的实践的。然后刚才提问的成员他们在这次 KubeCon 上会有个分享，就是用 KWOK， 就是 KWOK 的那个测试项目，他们可以用来模拟一些常见的，比方说某一个 node 它出现了什么样的 exit code 呀，它可能会有什么样的 log 呀，那这部分是可以通过他们的项目和经验进行分享的。然后除此以外，我们还知道就是Run 点 AI， 就是 Run AI， 他们有一个 Fake GPU Operator 去帮忙在 Node 的资源管理的层面上去说有没有足够资源，是否出现了什么样的 GPU 资源报错，这个是也已知的。那么回答你的问题，就是我们并没有一个可行的最佳实践。那我期望是我们也许能够和英伟达或者说任何的合作伙伴一起去把这些错误给记录下来，然后可能做一些分析啊，或者说改进它的分析算法的实现。
OK， 好，谢谢。
我想问一个那个刚才五个 feature 里面最后一个是 migration 吗？OK，
对的。
OK， 那我的问题是这样，就是作为一个 GPU 的训练集群的话，它的资源是很紧张的，我们会 use all of the GPUs， OK， 所有的 GPU 都会用上。那如果 GPU 坏了，那如何处理呢？其实你没有办法 migration。
对，是这样的，尤其是对于我们已知的情况，比方说在使用 Megatron 或者 DeepSpeed 进行张量并行或者说流水线并行训练的时候，假设说我们现在开始了一个训练，它是四乘四的一个张量并行 TP 和 PP 的分配，那么在出现错误之后，我们必须要有相同的四个四乘四，也就是16张 GPU 去单独跑这个训练任务，才能进行成功的迁移，这个是我们也已知的问题。然后确实我们不能够对 GPU 做什么样的操作，我们唯一能进行的就是把出现问题的节点的 event 记录下来，然后上报到 NPT 那边，或者上报到节点事件那边，方便其他 controller 或者说我们之后去 kcover 里面支持，才能实现更好的这种 GPU 的容错和迁移。嗯，不知道有没有回答。
OK， 谢谢。
Thanks. My question is that does your system handle, utilize, say, domain-specific knowledge? For example, does kcover need to know whether I'm doing TP, PP, like 3D dimensions, things like that? Or it just, you know, it's a black box job, it's running?
Okay, just give me a moment. Let me find how it is used.Okay, sure. Look at this. Actually, our proposal or best practice recommendation will be using label with operators to tag the essential resources to identify which will be used for cascading or grouping them as for cascading. Yes. Or a more precise version of thisanswer would be, how about implement a dedicated operator that can be able to aware how TP and PP were configured, so TP, PP can reflect to the actual resources or pods. Then you can label them as one group. Therefore, we will have the cascading shutdown and entirely mitigation.Is my answer efficient?
我中文问吧，就是，就是是那个 kcover 是否会用到，就是那个那就是它你的 training workload 在做 TP 或者是 PP， 然后会做出相应的那个 debug information 是这样子，还是说你只是把它当做一个黑盒去整个去 run， 然后就无所谓它做 TP、PP、DP 的 dimension？
对，我们没有做任何处理。纯粹就是建议说，在 operator 或者说资源创建的时候，我们知道哪些资源是受影响的，它是同一个组，同一个 TP 和 PP 的组的，那我们就打个 label 上去声明它是需要做 recovery 的。
Okay, 还有一个小问题，就是你们如何 handle 就是焊住的问题，就是或者是说有没有，因为你现在提到的大部分都是 failure 的问题嘛，就是它可能就挂了，但是我们经常 practice 会遇到它就焊在那个地方，那跑了几个小时焊住了，这种特别难搞。然后你们有没有相关的一些 comments？
稍等，我把那个东西拿出来。did my work? Did that work?Oh, sorry, that's not the slide. 啊，我直接说吧，就是对于焊住的问题，我们已知的情况有两种，其中一种是 Nico 卡住了，也就是网卡卡住了，或者说网络通信或者 IO 卡住了。对于这种情况下，一般来说，通过重启它，直接把那个 PID 给 Q 掉，是能解决问题的。但对于我们而言，我们就是单纯的实现把它整个资源都 Q 掉，把它整个资源都删掉，这样去处理。那对于另外一个，也就是第二种情况，就是我从我在米哈游工作的一个伙伴那里听到的，他给我介绍的是，他们在做云服务的基础设施的时候， 会遇到的是 PCIe 整个 socket 都焊住了。在这种情况下 kernel 是卡住的， kernel 没有办法去做出任何反应， Q 是没有不管用的，甚至整个系统都会焊住。这个时候唯一的办法就是按照他们说的，就是把这个玩家踢下线，然后重新把一个新的 VM 分给玩家，以此来实现。那反映到我们这个 Kubernetes 这个视角上来看呢，它应该就是把整个 node 都 shut down， 然后重新启动一下，看看它会不会恢复。如果不能恢复呢，大概率是 PCIe 通道出现了问题。这是我们以这两种情况。那对于这两种情况，我回应你的就是我们是否有知道有什么样的好的解决方法，答案是没有。所以说我会在最后一个 slide 里面说，建议社区还有每一个框架，不管是什么样的框架， PyTorch 也好， JAX 也好，都去实现一个健康检查的 API， 这样至少从它的持续运行状况来看，我们是可以知道啊，它有没有继续在 responding 的。否则，哦，那我们可能认为它是503啊，或者说出现了什么问题。对，这个是焊住，应该是提供一些可观测能力暴露出来才能够解决的。
Thanks.
Any question?
When I look at the slides, I see that most of the errors you're referring are the irreversible errors, right? So what about the reversible errors? Do you do anything about them?
Sorry, pardon? What about the irreversible issues?
就是我用中文说的话，就是你列出来的错误都是可以，就不可挽回的错误，对吧？
对。
那对于可挽回的错误，你们这边会做任何的？
可挽回的错误一般应该是由 trainer 自己去实现的，
就是用户自己去，
对，应该是框架自行解决。
OK， 明白。
对，我们解决的其实是就是框架现在没实现，但是我们也许提供了 k cover 能够提供一部分的解决能力。然后站在更远的视角来看呢，我们希望说能把 k cover 拓展到比方说感知到存储有问题，我们能对存储相关的业务进行一个 migration， 就它不仅仅是专注于 GPU 或者说 AI workload 了。
那如果还有刚才有个人提到let me use English first. So, when you do not have enough resource to migrate your existing workloads, do you use like autoscaler to increase your cluster size so you can like migrate your workloads? Do you do that or no?
We haven't experimented it.But I think that's possible to integrate. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. 走吧。那谢谢大家，谢谢。Thank you to everyone to attend to our session.